Building Green on BCTV is supported by BARDA.
Good morning. Welcome to Building Green. If you're watching this broadcast, it's February, the second Tuesday in February. The program, its time slot is the second Tuesday of each month at 10:30. We recorded the program you're about to watch in January so that we didn't have to drag my guest here from out of town. So for those of you with keen eyes, you'll notice that we're wearing the same clothes as in January. Anyway, welcome. And last month, in the first half of this program, we talked in general about the state of things. And for the bulk of today's program, we're going to be focusing on what Penn Future is doing in Pennsylvania to move the agenda in terms of combating climate change along. And Jacqui is returned as my guest, and I'll reintroduce you. She's the president and CEO of Penn Future. So before we get talking about Penn Future, there are a couple of things that maybe we can just come back to. One of which, just to sort of set the stage, one of the things I did want to talk about in the first part of the program was the new Green Deal. And I just wanted to get your thoughts about that. First of all, it's what I know of it is that it's coming out of mostly the energy is coming from the new crop of legislators elected in November, correct? In the House, mostly. So if you could just talk a little bit about what you know of it and why you think it matters or doesn't matter. Is it a kind of a nice term that's going to go nowhere, I guess?
So thanks again for having me. It's great to be back. So the Green New Deal or the New Green Deal as emerging from the new Congress in particular feels exciting and important. So we know that what's being looked at is a package of ideas and programs that will largely center on economy, new economy, and jobs as an opportunity to build prosperity through sustainability and through a much bigger set of investments around renewable energy that will have a major impact on our ability to deal with climate change. And so we talked a little bit about how important it is for activists and the environmental community to continue to fight against fossil fuel interests and politicians that have us on a trajectory to a dark climate future. But this is a viable idea and a viable path forward, not only for our nation, but for Pennsylvania. And so we're very excited about it. I'm happy to report that one of Penn Future's board members, prominent climate scientist from Penn State, Michael Mann, is active in shaping the new the New Deal around climate and green. And so I expect that if there is work for Penn Future to do, we'll have lots of encouragement from our board and others to do that on the national level.
So another cause for optimism at the federal level is the Climate Change Caucus that was kind of killed by the Republican control is now being reinstituted. Is that what it's called? I'm not sure if that's the term.
I think it's called the Climate Caucus. Okay. And we also have a Climate Caucus in Pennsylvania, that launched just a couple of years ago. And I'm hoping that they will continue to do some good work capturing the attention of the public around and concern around these issues.
So one of the things we're going to talk about as we lead into the conversation about what Penn Future's doing is what's happening at the state. So, but before, just to sort of set the stage of why in Pennsylvania it kind of matters to think about how we produce this, I believe this chart, these numbers refer to Pennsylvania as a state relative to the other 49 states. Is that
mm-hmm,
correct?
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if you want to say anything about this, but it's like we're number two and three, and the one in red is probably the most concerning.
Right. So this set of energy facts is illustrative of the situation that Pennsylvania is the third highest emission of carbon dioxide in the country. And my sense is that if we also factored in methane emissions associated with being natural number two in natural gas production, our contribution to the climate crisis is highly, highly significant. And it's no longer appropriate that we are not aggressively working to do something about it. Having said that, I think that there's always cause for concern, but also a cause for optimism
okay.
that I think is worth talking about.
Okay, let's talk about optimism.
So let's before I talk about optimism, I'm going to talk about the concern.
Sure.
So we talked about the fact that in November, the electorate in Pennsylvania brought in the most pro-environmental class, largest and pro-environmental class of legislators in a long time here in Pennsylvania. And so that means that there will be more folks in the legislature that are going to be enlightened to environmental issues. Unfortunately, if I could read between the lines, rather than acknowledge the fact that the electorate did go a little bit greener in November, and look to moderate, we've seen some really concerning things happen. So Speaker of the House Mike Terzai has named Daryl Metcalf, a legislator from Western Pennsylvania, as the new chair of the Energy and Environment Committee, which tells me that there's going to be a very tall wall around any pro-environmental legislation making its way out of that committee and out of that caucus. Having said that, though, the governor is back for a second term. Lieutenant Governor Fetterman feels like a breath of fresh air, and the governor continues to have some very strong folks in the secretary positions in departments of agriculture, Department of Environmental Protection, Department of Conservation and Natural Resources, and even PennDOT that have a role to play. The governor is talking about the fact that there is a climate crisis and has indicated that he is wanting to address solutions. And so we see DEP wrapping up the latest version of its climate action plan. I urge everyone who's watching today to spend some time with that report. It's both educational as well as instructive in terms of recommendations of what we could do as a state and individuals. The Department of Conservation.
And it's easy to find, right?
And
you
it's
just
easy
go to the
find.
Website and it's
go to
you do
DEP
it's a climate
website,
the action plan.
Climate
right?
Action Plan,
yeah.
DEP. Yeah.
It's a nice looking document, actually.
The other things that are important to note is that in addition to emissions from utilities, coal and gas utilities. Transportation and cars continue to be a major emitter of greenhouse gas. Pennsylvania just joined the Transportation Climate Initiative. It's an 8-state regional initiative that will be hashing out a plan to lower greenhouse gas emissions. We talked a little bit about the Solar Future plan that Pennsylvania has to ramp up through some pretty exciting pathways, the use and development of solar energy here in the coming years, and that feels important and exciting as well. I'm going to pause, and we could maybe talk about some of the vehicles, but let me just pause for a moment and see where you want to take this.
Well, okay, we're going to talk about what Penn Future's, what your organization's plans are to take advantage of what appears to be optimism and level of crisis. But is there something any more specific, or do you want to say anything more about what we might expect in the coming months or the coming year? Are there some things that you have a sense in certain arenas that are going to come out of Harrisburg, whether it's with something like the Green New Deal or with solar, wind, or renewables in general? Is there some expectation that we're actually going to, it's going to be more than just Wolfish doing a press conference, which sounds good, and then nothing ever happens?
Well, I think we're optimistic that the governor is going to be able to do quite a bit through executive action. And the reason that that's important mm-hmm. is that, you know, the state owns a lot of real estate, the state uses a lot of power, the state has a lot of infrastructure and buildings under their mm-hmm. Under their jurisdiction. And, you know, just tackling efficiencies alone could be a significant part of the solution. It gets a little bit trickier when we move to the legislature, the reason that I say that is that the nuclear industry in Pennsylvania, it's been around for a long time. We rely on nuclear power for quite a bit of our energy here. Some of that obviously is exported. But that industry is operating pretty close to the margin, mm-hmm. And is
you mean economically?
Economically, the economic margin, and is frankly looking for some help. I don't think anybody mm-hmm. is really crazy about nuclear power. I think I could say that because I live about 7 miles as the crow flies from a nuclear power plant. And certainly there are a lot of concerns around waste. But from a greenhouse gas emissions, we can't ignore the fact that there's not a major contribution mm-hmm. there. Mm-hmm. And taking those nukes offline could dig us into mm-hmm. an even more adverse mm-hmm. climate situation mm-hmm. that we're mm-hmm. in right now. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of conversation about the nuclear bailout. And whether or not that could be advanced in a marriage with some incentives around increasing renewables, increasing our alternative energy portfolio mm-hmm. standard, and that feels particularly viable and a little bit tricky.
But I
think that given the climate crisis, we owe it to, at least Penn Future owes it, to ourselves and to our constituents and our constituents of the future to take a serious look at this.
Yeah. Part of generally my sort of base optimism is that the economic argument has gotten much easier to make and much more real in terms of renewables. The cost of generating solar, the cost of generating electricity with solar or wind, it's just starting to make more economic sense. And then when you plug in the whole notion of job creation, a lot of the counter arguments that didn't really make a lot of sense anyway to people with our perspective, but they made sense to people who think about things in a different way. And I think that it keeps looking more and more favorable in that regard.
It does.
And things happening at the international level. Unless there's some other general comment you want to make about the cause for optimism, maybe we should start looking a little bit at what Penn Future is going to be doing and what it's planning to do.
Yeah, but maybe we could do a little bit of both.
Yeah, sure. Okay.
So the other thing that's out there that feels really important is in the wake of President Trump withdrawing the United States from the Paris Climate Accord, we've seen a real upwelling from communities and mayors, city councils, who don't want to go in the opposite direction. And there's a movement that's called We're Still In. And here in Pennsylvania, we've got quite a few mayors, quite a few communities. In fact, I think that the city of Reading last year passed a very pro-climate, possibly the second resolution out of council. And so one of the things that Penn Future is doing, a new program that's being created, is our Clean Energy Communities program that we are piloting right now in Western Pennsylvania, essentially working with climate-minded elected officials, helping them build a cadre of stakeholders, and developing plans for increased renewable energy installations and energy efficiency in each of their communities as a way to take their climate future into their own hands. So it's a pretty significant move into technical assistance for Penn Future, but we think that, number one, the expertise that we have in our organization is needed at the local level, and we're finding ways to get that out at the local level.
So you're saying it's being piloted in Western Pennsylvania. The thinking is that if it will be successful. When it's successful, it will go state. You'll kind of spread it to other parts of the state.
Correct, including central Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. You mentioned, again, this is not specific to Pennsylvania, but you mentioned there are a lot of municipalities in the state. And as I understand, it's like 29 states in the wake of the federal government pulling out of the Paris Accords, 29 states have signed on similar to We're Still In, right? Is that correct?
Right, yeah.
I've heard that number.
I'm not exactly sure how many states,
maybe.
But I think here in Pennsylvania, we've got, well over 20 communities, 20 mayors. I believe that there are over 60 businesses, academic institutions, that have also philanthropies that have also sort of signed on to keep moving ahead and take climate future into their own hands.
Okay, that's great. Okay, so where would you like to take this conversation next in terms of, I think this is great, sort of talking about things that are happening and cause for optimism. What other areas of focus? So that's called the Clean Energy Communities?
Clean Energy Communities, possibly coming close to a community near you.
I just want to mention, because at this point people are probably going, well, how do we find out? So the Penn Future website is?
PennFuture.org.
Okay, easy. So we'll mention that again at the end, but this and the other, everything else, and a lot of valuable information on that website. Penn Future, not futures, PennFuture.org.
Right. Okay. So the next big play is going to be in the state legislature, where we're going to be keeping our eye on both attacks on environmental protections that have been gained in the past by anti-nuclear forces in the legislature. So we need those of you that are out there and inclined toward advocacy to work with us and keep your eye on that ball and communicate with your legislators in terms of why that's just not acceptable. that's the defensive piece. On the policy side, we talked a little bit about the possibility for a proactive package to be coming out of the legislature tied to the nuclear bailout around any number of programs that would help us reduce greenhouse gas emissions in the state. The other thing that's happening that feels really exciting is around, let's just say, climate-friendly transportation. And this isn't really about going out and buying a shiny new Prius or Tesla. But keep in mind that, you know, this technology and these vehicles have been on the market for a long time. It's really nice to fill up your tank and have 640 miles to go before it's empty. So I definitely encourage people to think about climate-friendly transportation. Pennsylvania is advancing a program of incentives called Driving Pennsylvania Forward. So there are grants that are available through the Volkswagen settlement that came to Pennsylvania, where businesses and communities can actually be doing much more in terms of installing electrical vehicle charging stations. Mm-hmm. So there's an opportunity there and money that's available. And so those are just a couple of other suggestions of opportunities for people to engage around this issue.
So I'm just a little bit confused. When you started talking about climate-friendly transportation, you were saying, I'm not suggesting people go out and buy their Teslas and Toyotas. What did you mean by that?
Suggesting that this isn't about buying a brand new one, but if you don't drive a hybrid or electric vehicle, you might think about purchasing one. They're out there.
Oh, I see that there may be out there even secondhand now.
So, you know, next time you're in the market for a car, don't overlook that. So there's all kinds of decisions and choices around transportation, biking, transit, train, to get people out of out of their cars by themselves. And it feels small, but it's an important choice.
The other one, I used to beat this to death, but even choices in terms of where you live, because there are a lot of places you can live where you don't have to hop in a car every time you go buy a bag of groceries or go to work. There are bike and pedestrian friendly communities throughout Pennsylvania, and I think people need to think about that if they're serious about climate change. As soon as you get in the car and you go somewhere, even with electrical generation, I mean, if the electricity is being generated by wind or solar, it's one thing. If it's being generated by a coal plant, it's still fossil fuel.
Right.
It's better, as I understand, the emissions are better overall, but it's a complicated conversation, but I'm nice to know there might be some used ones out there. I did read an article recently that said that if you're thinking about getting an electric car, wait about a year or two, because there are going to be a lot more companies are introducing electric cars. Now, I don't know, are they going to be in the Tesla range of price, or are they going to be more affordable? That's yet to be seen, but I imagine as there's more of them, they will become more affordable.
Yeah.
That's a third one. Is there another one? Do we need to go to any of these slides that we had here for? You mentioned climate. Let's just bring up these real quickly. This is climate-friendly transportation. I guess this just illustrates what you just had said. Can we bring this up?
Double-click on that, maybe.
Got it. It's on this one. No.
Here we go.
Okay, hybrid vehicles, electric transit. Okay, so you mentioned all of that. These two that talk about working, we'll come to educate yourself before we sign off.
We talked about the policy opportunities. There's also a little bit more that could be done on the local level. If you want to just double click on that.
The local level,
yep.
Okay.
So last year, the legislature passed a program called CPACE, which stands for Commercial Property Assessed Clean Energy. And essentially what this does is provide incentives for commercial interests and agriculture to do energy installations in their places of business. The trick here is that the taxing body, which tends to be a local municipality, has to set up the program for this to actually happen. So it's an opportunity to talk to your local elected officials about an important program to get more clean energy installations on the ground.
Okay. So that's where people can get active locally and press their municipalities to do something. Okay. Well, we have a couple minutes left. Let's bring up this one remaining slide. This is basically what can you recommend that people do? It's always a question. Well, what can I do? How can I? Not on this list is contacting your elected officials at the local level, at the state level.
That's right.
And the federal level, and tell them you want stuff to happen.
Right. Let's not forget the fact that in Pennsylvania, we have an opportunity to buy and choose the electricity of our choice. So papowerswitch.com is the website that you go to actually do that. There's competitive pricing. You could purchase renewables. The other thing is a lot of communities are engaged in tree planting, both in terms of beautification, but it's also an opportunity to take up greenhouse gas emissions. And then, last but not least, elections matter. We need good candidates. We need pro-environment, pro-climate candidates. Consider running. Educate yourself around, if you're not going to run, about the candidates out there that are pro-environment, advancing solutions, vote. We just had an election. There'll be another one soon enough. At the end of the day, civic engagement and practicing democracy is a responsibility that's going to solve a lot of these solutions if we get the right people in there.
Yeah, I think that some of the initiatives you kind of touched on at the state level, the Green New Deal, I think those things, what they do is they sort of raise the awareness and raise the ante, and it may mean that we have to have another election cycle before we get majorities or enough people in place at both the state and national level to actually deal with this legislatively. So I want to thank you again for taking the time to come and be my guest.
Thanks for having me.
You delivered. It was a conversation I was hoping to have. Good. And good luck in the coming year. Let's hope we have some things to celebrate this time next year.
I'd love to be back celebrating next year at this time.
Okay.
Maybe
thanks
for everything.
We'll do an assessment next year.
Sounds good.
Okay. Thanks, Jacqui.
You're
so thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you next month.
Building Green on BCTV is supported by BARDA.